Good afternoon, everyone. Just before we begin, there's a few announcements I'd like to pass by you. And in case you didn't see the sign on the way in, it's a big green sign there telling you to shut off your phones and your cameras and all those devices because they want to have this view unobstructed. We're also live streaming, so be aware of that camera and things going on with the photography. The bride and groom would like to get the best shots possible, and so they've hired a professional. You don't need to actually contribute to that. So that's the first thing. Bathrooms downstairs and across the past the dining table and down the little hallway. Invited guests to the reception at the Barrel House on McDonald Street at 5 o'clock. But everyone can mingle here. There's a mingling time after the ceremony, and the bride and groom and everyone will stick around here and just mix with all of you who aren't able to attend the reception. Also, some of you, a lot of you, missed signing the guest book as you came in. And that's okay, because as we mingle after the service, please, if you can remember to sign that, so they have a record of who's here and who's not. No. Speaking of that, I was going to give the live stream, it's being live streamed, I was going to give the live stream address, but anyone who's watching the live stream has the address, and anyone not watching it, it wouldn't matter if I gave it anyway. So those are the announcements, and we'll begin in just a couple of minutes.
First a boy and a girl meet each other, then they sit down to talk for a while. step,
each step
draws you closer,
closer to the
ideal. You may start with a simple conversation, like, darling, please put me on trial. She says yes, and your heart starts beating, while
each step
draws you closer,
closer
to the eye. You ask her if she loves you, she answers, I do. Your heart starts glowing inside, and then you will know she is just for you, while
each step
draws you closer, closer to the eye.
Start. Very good. Let's begin with a call to worship from 1 John chapter 4. Beloved, let us love one another, for love is from God, and everyone who loves is born of God and knows God. The one who does not love does not know God, for God is love. By this, the love of God was manifested in us, that God has sent his only begotten Son into the world so that we might live through him. Let's pray together. Heavenly Father, love has been your richest and greatest gift to the world. The love between a man and a woman that matures into a marriage relationship is the most beautiful picture of the love that you have for us in Christ's gospel. Today we celebrate that love. Your love to save lost mankind by sending Christ to die for us, and the love that is in a marriage relationship. May your blessing be on this marriage ceremony of Daniel and Janneke today. This is a day for celebration and thanksgiving as we are gathered together here to offer our blessings and our witness to the marriage of this couple. They've invited us to share in the public declaration of their love and commitment to one another, and I consider it an honor and a privilege to be here, and I trust you do as well. And now as we begin this service, we'd like to start with a word from God in his word, Genesis chapter 12, and Carrie is going to come, Genesis chapter 2, sorry. I don't want to throw her off.
Today's scripture is taken from Genesis 2, 18 to 24. Then the Lord God said, "It is not good that the man should be alone. I will make him a helper fit for him." Now out of the ground, the Lord God had formed every beast of the field and every bird of the heavens, and brought them to the man to see what he would call them. And whatever the man called every living creature, that was its name. The man gave names to all livestock and to the birds of the heavens and to every beast of the field. But for Adam, there was not found a helper fit for him. So the Lord God caused a deep sleep to fall upon the man. And while he slept, took one of his ribs and closed up its place with flesh. And the rib that the Lord God had taken from the man, he made into a woman and brought her to the man. Then the man said, This at last is bone of my bones and flesh of my flesh. She shall be called woman, because she was taken out of man. Therefore, a man should leave his father and his mother and hold fast to his wife, and they shall become one flesh."
We're going to call Caleb up to lead us in some worship.
Jesus is calling. Have you come to the end of yourself? Do you thirst for a drink from the well? Jesus is calling. Oh, come to the altar. The Father's arms are open wide. Forgiveness was bought with the precious blood of Jesus Christ. Leave behind your regrets and mistakes. Come today, there's no reason to wait. Jesus is calling. Trade your sorrows and trade them for joy. From the ashes a new life is born. Jesus is calling. Oh, come to the altar. The Father's arms are open wide. Forgiveness was bought with the precious blood of Jesus Christ. Oh, come to the altar. The Father's arms are open wide. Forgiveness was bought with the precious blood of Jesus Christ. Oh, what a Savior! Isn't He wonderful? Sing hallelujah. Christ is risen. Bow down before Him, for He is Lord of all. Sing hallelujah. Christ is risen. Oh, what a Savior! Isn't He wonderful? Sing hallelujah. Christ is risen.
Oh, come.
Oh, come to the altar. The Father's arms are open wide. Forgiveness was bought away. The precious blood of Jesus Christ. Oh, come to the altar. The Father's arms are open wide. Forgiveness was bought with the precious blood of Jesus. You done murder for me on that cross, accused in absence of wrong, my sin washed away in your blood. Too much to make sense of it all. I know that your love breaks my fall. The scandal of grace died in my place, so my soul will live. Oh, to be like You, give all I have just to know You. Jesus, there's no one beside You. Forever the hope in my heart.
you've done. Power is as dead as my sin. The cross has taught me to live. Sin washed away in your blood. The day and its troubles shall come. I know that your love is enough. The scandal of grace, you died in my place, so my soul will live. Oh, to be like you, give all I have just to know you. Jesus, there's no one beside you. Forever the hope in my heart. And it's all because of you, Jesus, it's all because of you, Jesus, it's all because of your love that my soul will live. And it's all because of you, Jesus, it's all because of you, Jesus, it's all because of your love that my soul will live. Oh, to be like you, give all I have just to know you. Jesus, there's no one beside you. Forever the hope in my heart. Oh, to be like give all I have just to know you. Jesus, there's no one beside you. Forever the hope in my heart.
So we all know why we're here, and we will see this young couple in love being joined together in marriage. And as was read in our scripture reading, marriage has been established by God so that a man and a woman might have companionship, that natural affections might be fulfilled in mutual love, that children would have the benefit of family life and love, and that our society might rest on a firm foundation. In Scripture, the love between a husband and wife is compared to the love that Christ has for his church, also called his bride. We're commanded to follow his pattern and example, and so we have a vision of what marriage ought to be. It's a life of mutual self-giving love. Marriage is therefore not to be entered into lightly or carelessly, but thoughtfully, seriously, soberly, and in reverence before God. I got to know this young couple over many months now, and many weeks in my office, where I saw their love for one another and their deep love for God. And they are in love with that God who they recognize as their creator, their savior, the one who sustains their life, the one triune God of heaven, God who is the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. And so in preparing, in counseling, preparing young couples for things they might not think about or know about and how to deal with after they are joined in marriage and the honeymoon is over and life together looks nothing like they imagined. Or maybe they have imagined some things, not sure, but I thought about the advice that Papa Hank gave last night at the rehearsal dinner, that the first 25 years is an adjustment period. That sort of fits in with what I also warn husbands about in those counseling sessions, as the Apostle Peter tells husbands in chapter 5 of his first letter to live with their wives in an understanding way. And I've always found that just when you think you understand them, they are all of a sudden past that phase in life, and, well, truly you have to work at it daily so that, again, from the Apostle Peter finishing that verse, your prayers will not be hindered. This is the part of the ceremony where I would normally bring a charge or a challenge to the bride and groom. I would urge them to trust and follow their Lord and King so that by the power of the Holy Spirit, their marriage would be blessed and would be a blessing to others, pointing their friends and family to their Lord and Savior. But they asked that this not be a challenge specifically aimed at them. I guess they figured I'd challenge them enough in their premarital counseling. So instead, in this ceremony setting this afternoon, they've asked me to help all of us focus on the truths of the gospel of Jesus Christ, or the good news of the gospel. The Apostle Paul tells us in his letter to the Ephesian church that Christ has redeemed a group of people as his promised bride. Jesus came to this earth to pay the bride price, or the dowry price. It's the price of redemption to redeem a people who are slaves to sin in their natural selves and making them or turning them or creating them into the children of righteousness. And all people who turn from trusting in themselves to save themselves by their good works, but who instead turn to trust in Christ's work on the cross for their redemption of their souls, that is who his bride is. It's a bride that comes from every race and language and people and nation. In other words, it's what he, through his word, also calls the church. Jesus came the first time 2,000 years ago to die for his bride, to pay that price for her with his own blood. And that is how precious his bride is to him. And he will come a second time to take his promised bride, and using Solomon's language from the Songs of Solomon, he will take her into the gardens and the chambers of his love and joy forever. So Paul, in Ephesians 5, partially quoting Genesis 2:24, says that a man shall leave his father and mother and hold fast to his wife, and the two shall become one flesh. That's Genesis 2:24 that Carrie has read. Then Paul adds, this mystery is profound, and I'm saying that it refers to Christ and the church. The joining in marriage that all of us are a witness to here today is God's illustration to this lost, hurting world, to see that there's more to it than just a man and a woman being joined together and living happily ever after. There's an order to marriage that God lays out through Paul in Ephesians, that when we follow his ways, marriage will fulfill the purpose for which it was intended. The purpose was not to make each other happy. That is an impossible task. The purpose is that we would find our fulfillment in Christ. And as we do that, or to do that, Paul says, wives, submit to your own husbands as to the Lord. For the husband is the head of the wife, even as Christ is the head of the church, his body, and is himself its Savior. Now, as the church submits to Christ, so also wives should submit in everything to their husbands, so that he might present the church to himself in splendor, without spot or wrinkle or any such thing, that she might be holy, without blemish. In the same way, husbands should love their wives as their own bodies. He who loves his wife loves himself, for no one ever hated his own body, but nourishes it and cherishes it, just as Christ does his church, because we are members of his body. Husbands, love your wives as Christ loved the church and gave himself up for her. And that can raise a lot of eyebrows in our day, but it is a beautiful thing when we understand our God-given roles. It's a wonderful thing because it is a glorious picture of Christ's relationship with his bride. King Jesus came into the world to take a wife to himself and give her pleasures that will make anything on this earth that a husband and a wife can share in this life, I always say, taste like cardboard. Now, that's not a nice definition, but I've told our congregation in the past, I could enjoy cardboard if it's wrapped in bacon. But this is better than even bacon, or whatever else it is that you might see as your greatest joy in life, even marriage. And he's now at work through people like Daniel and Yannicka, by his spirit and by his word, purifying and making his bride beautiful for the day that he returns for her and is ultimately working for her ultimate joy, eternal life. The Apostle Paul saw his ministry as a kind of a go-between for his Lord and for the church, as the one Christ is wooing to himself. Paul said to the Christians in Corinth, "I feel a divine jealousy for you, for I betrothed you to one husband to present you as a pure virgin to Christ." So Daniel and Yannicka are using this occasion of their wedding, this wonderful time of celebrating their love for each other as they become husband and wife, but also to be used as instruments that God would reach out to all of those who they love, hoping that they would be led to put their trust in Christ, to enjoy him forever as part of his bride. Their desire, through the word of God, by the conviction of the Holy Spirit, is that God would open spiritual eyes and spiritual ears to see and to hear the beauty of Christ and to place your faith and trust in him, thus growing his bride. Their desire is also that those who do know him, that your love for Christ would deepen, preparing and purifying his church. For now the bridegroom waits in heaven until the appointed time of his return. As his betrothed bride, we long for him. In fact, listen to these words from Paul in Romans chapter 8. "For I consider that the sufferings of this present time are not worth comparing with the glory that is to be revealed in us. For we know that the whole creation has been groaning together in the pains of childbirth until now. And not only the creation, but we ourselves, who have the first fruits of the Spirit, groan inwardly as we wait eagerly for adoption as sons, the redemption of our bodies. For in this hope we were saved. Now hope that is seen is not hope, for who hopes for what he sees? But if we hope for what we do not see, we wait for it with patience. We wait patiently with hope, also with groaning, as we long for the bridegroom to come and take us into his presence forever." It's like a husband and a wife madly in love who are separated for a time due to any number of or variety of reasons, but they eagerly wait for the day that they are both home together. My bride has been in Newfoundland for the last week, and she's coming home in a few days, and I can't wait, but that's a different story. The last book of the Bible, the revelation of Jesus Christ to the Apostle John, tells us how this world will end and speaks of the world that is to come. In Revelation chapter 19, John describes that event of being home together like this. He says, "I heard what seemed to be the voice of a great multitude, like the roar of many waters and like the sound of mighty peals of thunder, crying out, 'Hallelujah, for the Lord our God, the Almighty, reigns. Let us rejoice and exalt and give him the glory, for the marriage of the Lamb has come and his bride has made herself ready. It was granted her to clothe herself with fine linen, bright and pure, for the fine linen is the righteous deeds of the saints.' And the angel said to me, 'Write this: Blessed are those who are invited to the marriage supper of the Lamb.'" So as Daniel and Yannicka are joined together in the holy estate of marriage, we love them, we rejoice with them, we celebrate with them, while they, of course, love us and appreciate our love and support. But again, they would truly love that our focus not be solely on them and to be eagerly awaiting that and longing to eat the delicious meal after this wedding reception. All who confess their sin and acknowledge it before God and repents, returns from it, and places their trust in Christ and in his finished work on the cross, belong to his bride and are invited to the marriage supper. Not every person will be part of the marriage supper of the Lamb. Some will be sitting at the reception eating a meal together, but it's only those whom Daniel and Yannicka have invited to their reception meal that will eat. I'm sorry, but they can't feed the entire city. But it's the same with the marriage supper of the Lamb. Sadly, some will be outside wishing they could get in and will be received in another place. It's a place the Bible calls hell, and Jesus says that there is great torment there for people who refuse to trust him and instead choose to pay for their sin themselves. So I, along with Daniel and Yannicka, give you or urge you to receive God's invitation to trust in Christ's sacrifice that pays for your sin. Love Christ as Lord. Become a part of his bride. The joys he will give are beyond anything experienced or imagined in this present earth. Do you have a seat at the table of the marriage supper of the Lamb? Are you assured of being at that great meal? To conclude the book of Revelation, John writes, "The Spirit and the bride say, come. And let the one who hears say, come. And let the one who is thirsty say, come. Let the one who desires take the water of life without price." Daniel and Yannicka are thrilled that you've accepted their invitation to join them here today, but nothing would thrill their hearts more than if you would receive the King's invitation to become part of his bride and one day be in his presence forever. In his presence, where the psalmist says, there is fullness of joy, and at his right hand are pleasures forevermore. So they, along with myself, would ask that you think on these things, these truths. Think on God's invitation to the great marriage supper to end all marriage suppers, the celebration of the joining of Christ forever with his bride, because that is what we witness in this ceremony, joining this beautiful young couple together as husband and wife. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we are thrilled, overjoyed, and so love this young couple that we have let them know that by being here today. But Father, also they know that you are here and you are working in their hearts, and I pray that you would be working on all of our hearts as we witness this ceremony that is just a picture of the greatest ceremony in this universe, Father, the joining of Christ, the bridegroom, and his bride, the church. And so thank you for this couple. Thank you for this time that we can join them in this special day as they commit their lives to one another and their hearts to God in Jesus' name. Amen. I'll ask Papa Hank to come. And the bridal party.
Who gives this woman to be wedded to this man? Daniel, do you know any lawful impediment that would be a reason for this marriage not to take place?
I do not.
Yannicka, do you know any lawful impediment that would be reason for this marriage not to take place?
I do not.
Daniel, will you take Yannicka to be your wedded wife, to live together in a holy state of marriage? Will you love her, comfort her, honor and keep her through all the circumstances of life, and forsaking all others, keep only to her? Yannicka, will you take Daniel to be your wedded husband, to live together in a holy state of marriage? Will you love him, comfort him, honor, keep him through all the circumstances of life, and forsake all others, keep only to him?
Yannicka, my warm, two words in, passionate, patient, and beautiful bride. When we first started dating, I asked you if you wanted to join me on a challenging and exciting journey with me, and you did not disappoint. I have experienced more than I ever could have asked for, and that was just the tip of the iceberg. I remember this incident before we started dating. This was the night right after your big car crash, to put it lightly, and I'm thankful and I praise God that you were virtually unharmed and was surprised to hear that you had arrange a get-together with our friends right here at The Habit, not even a full day having passed since you were hanging upside down from your seatbelt. Our friend Jill and I walked into the coffee shop that night, and there you were, sitting with a big, ear-to-ear, goofy, joy-filled smile. And I thought at that moment, I cannot imagine a world without you in it. During this experience, you also taught me something that I had the joy of witnessing over the last couple of years. Thank you. You have taught me that we should not be afraid to put in the effort and to deeply love the people around us without regard. And equally important, that we should not be afraid to communicate, that sometimes we just need their love and support. And so in the same stride, I now vow to continually communicate lovingly with you and to smile and laugh heartily with you as well. I vow, as Peter put it, to live with you in an understanding, considerate way, to learn intimately about you as we grow. I also vow to receive each ounce of grace from you while I'm learning with extreme gratitude. I vow to honor you as a precious person made in the image of God, as co-heirs of the grace of life in Christ. I vow to lay down my life and build you up in the gifts God has so specifically and beautifully placed in you, even through the rough patches and chaotic stages of our family. I understand that there has been and will be busy periods in our lives, periods where we are convinced that it's okay to not talk about our days or not to have date nights. And even so, being the better dancer that you are, slightly, I vow to never miss a beat with you. I vow to faithfully walk with you and sing with you, to dance with you, and to raise a family with you. Thank you, Andrew. I vow to always consider you with Jesus at our center, in sickness and in health.
Mine aren't that good. I'm joking. Switch. I'm not going to be able to get through this.
Daniel, you wrote a book, didn't you?
No. Yeah.
Okay. Oh, this is not going to go well. I'm trying. Deep breaths. I knew this was going to happen. Okay.
Breathe in.
Daniel. You're my rock, my light, my best friend, and my biggest crush. I first knew I loved you. I first knew I loved you when I realized you're the most generous person I'd ever meet. You give so freely, your time, money, trust, and love. And I'm so lucky to be the greatest receiver of the last one. And all the others. You care for me when I'm sick, laugh with me when I laugh, and cry with me when I cry, metaphorically, because you don't cry much except for right now.
Right now.
Most importantly, you've never made me feel like I can't be myself. There are so many things that I could vow to you, but I'll try to keep it simple. So we can keep going. I vow to try to love you as Christ loves us. I vow to try to laugh at all of your jokes and bad impressions. Keyword is try. I vow to always support you and to wake up every morning and choose to love you. Even when it's hard, even when it's easier not to, I promise that I'll always try my best. With you, I'll endure the hardest and the most joyful. With you, I'll be myself, which means that you'll get the meanest, grumpiest, hangriest, and sassiest versions of me, but also all the best. With you, I'll grow in my relationship with God and raise a godly family. With you, I will be, for better or worse, in sickness and in health, until God calls us home.
So, another book, huh? Right, time for rings. Daniel, repeat after me. I give you this ring.
I give you this ring.
As a sign of my love and loyalty.
As a sign of my love and loyalty.
That you may wear it.
That you may wear it.
As a symbol of our marriage.
As a symbol of our marriage.
Janika, repeat after me. Daniel, I give you this ring.
Daniel, I give you this ring.
As a sign of my love and loyalty.
As a sign of my love and loyalty.
That you may wear it as a symbol of our marriage.
That you may wear it as a symbol of our marriage.
Let these rings continue to be for both a symbol of value, purity, consistent of true wedded love, and as a sign and a seal of the vows that you just have made to one another before God and these witnesses. Pastor Anthony.
So, for as much as you, Daniel Shanlin She, and you, Janika Miriam Polki, have made this solemn covenant of marriage before God and before all of us here, and have pledged your vows to one another and have confirmed them by the joining of your hands and the giving and the receiving of the rings, I, as a minister of the gospel of Jesus Christ and his church, and by virtue of the powers given me through the Marriage Act of the Province of Ontario, and in the presence and name of God our Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, do hereby pronounce you to be husband and wife. You may now seal your vows with a kiss.
How come we're not surprised at what you did?
We found the day like we've always prayed. What we've seen, all that we've learned, built up to this day. Hold on to this heart and keep in step with me to walk along the path God made. And our Father spoken, this life we've chosen will help us follow your plan. And I can't profess that I understand it, but I see me holding your hand. heaven made your hand to complement my hand. Heaven made your heart to complement my heart. Heaven gave you love to complement my love. Heaven gave you love so one day we would love the way that God intended for us. And our Father spoken, this life we've chosen will help us follow your plan. And I can't profess that, I understand that, but I see me holding your hand. Hold on to this heart and keep inside your heart such faith. We'll walk along the path God made. And I fall spoken, this life we've chosen will help us follow your plan. And I can't profess that, I understand it, but I see me holding your hand. Heaven made your hand to complement my hand. Heaven made your heart to complement my heart. Heaven gave you love, so we would love one day the way that God intended. Hold on to this day and keep inside your heart such faith. We'll walk along the path God made.
They really want to stay married because they want to have two pastors officiating the ceremony. So that for certainly will be sealed. I told them I have a little surprise today for them. Janika's other grandfather is here from Sault Ste. Marie. He's going to join with me here on the platform, and we will pray, both of us, for you. It's interesting when you join two languages, when you join two cultures, it's a wonderful blend. And when you were talking about children, I know Andrew's hand was up immediately, and Sue, but my wife was also really anxious to, her hand is up now, to see a great grandchildren. And so, anyway, we'd like to pray for you, both of us, as grandparents and grandfathers. But of course, Janika is from that Finnish background, and Daniel is from Taiwan. And I asked Ahti, his other grandfather, to read Psalm 23 in Finn. And I wrote it down so that he has, and we will then pray after. Okay, I think he wants to say something else.
First, I'd like to wish you, Janika and Daniel, all the best. And may God be with you the rest of your life. And there may not be that many Finnish-speaking people here, but I'm going to say a prayer in Finnish. Herra on minun paimeneni, ei minulta mitään puutu. Vihreisille niityille hän vie minut lepäämään, virvoittelevien vetten tykö. Hän minut johdattaa, hän virvoittaa minun sieluni, hän ohjaa minun oikealle tielle nimensä tähden. Vaikka minä vaeltaisin pimeässä laaksossa, en minä pelkäisi mitään pahaa, sillä sinä olet minun kanssani. Sinun vitsasi ja sauvasi minua lohduttavat. Sinä valmistat minulle pöydän minun vihollisteni eteen. Sinä voitelet pääni öljyllä. Minun maljani on ylitsevuotavainen. Sula hyvyys ja laupeus seuraavat minua kaiken elinaikani. Ja minä saan asua Herran huoneessa päivieni loppuun asti.
Yeah, Lord, we are so blessed and we're so happy to be here today as grandfathers. Lord, we ask you mighty, mighty blessing on them in Jesus' powerful name. Whatever happens in life, whatever comes, that they can remember the Psalm 23 words and they keep those words and Psalm 23 before them. Doesn't matter where they are and whatever valley they are walking through, Lord Jesus, that you are there with them and for them. Amen. I also like to pray. There's a wonderful prayer in the Old Testament called Prayer of Jabez, but I really like to change it a little bit for them. Oh, Father, that you would bless them indeed, and enlarge their border, and that you would, your hand would be with them, and that you would keep them from harm, that it would not pain them. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Okay. Before I introduce them, just remember to sign the guest book as you go out, and they would like to know who was here. All right, ladies and gentlemen, family and friends, I now present to you Mr. and Mrs. Daniel and Janika Scheel.
Yeah.